I will be talking about the polarization subsystem in McStas. This is my main job, actually, so if there's anything you want to know about polarization in McStas, asking me is probably a reasonably good idea. I think you all got my email, so you're welcome to follow me at any time, and so please do. Right, so what I'll tell you about is how do we actually do polarization or polarized beams in MXS. So I'll remind you about the particle model in MXS. We have wave, position, velocity, and time, and we also have the polarization. And this is closely related to the spin of the neutron, but not quite. And here I've tried to put that down in formulas. So in a sense, the polarization of the beam is the mean of the polarization over the ray numbers. And what is that then? That is arguably a polarization of each ray is the polarization, or I should say, this is, I got this one. So the polarization of a ray, or the beam, is actually the mean, weighted mean by the means of the ray weight over a set of polarizations for each ray. Now, for each ray, representing a number of neutrons, you can say, the polarization for each ray is the mean over the neutrons that the ray represents. And the simultaneous, each of the polarization of the neutron rays is simply the mean over this Pauli operator. But in reality, these two numbers are what we're actually dealing with, because we don't really look into the spin of the, each neutron in the ray. We deal with the ray number, the polarization of each ray, and each and the mean polarization of the beam. So what do we actually monitor here? So consider a bunch of neutrons with a slight with a polarization to them, incoming in a monitor, and consider now some direction. It doesn't have to be up, it doesn't have to be down, it often is, but that's really by convention. Polarization is a 3D thing, so you can monitor polarization in any direction, which is this. And basically what it boils down to is monitoring the, is giving a number, given a vector, of how many neutrons happen to be spinning, have their spin in that direction. And if we cook, if you look at that, that means that we have access to only the mean polarization of each ray. But that just boils down to a weighted mean over all the rays projected on the direction that we're actually measuring. And this, so if we do that, monitor polarization as a function of wavelength, you can get a curve like this, going from 1 to minus 1 to 1 again. Polarization is always going to be between minus 1 and 1, right? No matter which direction you point at, you're measuring it. So the available monitors in MXS, some of you have seen them. There's a polarization monitor, it's a zero-beam thing. You specify a direction and it just gives you a number. You measure it this direction, it does the meaning, the compute the mean measured again along that direction. There's a pole lambda monitor, which is a 2D thing, which divides the polarization vector between 1 and minus 1 into a set of bins and then deposits intensity in these bits. So you get it's an intensity monitor as a function of wavelength and polarization along some direction. And obviously think of it, you can, if you really wanted to get a curve, like the one here, you can do a mean of that. And that means the mean polarization for a given wavelength in some direction. Right? In order to do anything with polarization, you generally need magnetic fields also. So that you can manipulate your polarization of the beam. And the challenge to a person like me, to understand what I'm trying to do here, is that I need to write some code that generates fast beam and rate transport, but I don't know anything about the magnetic field that the user is going to put in. We, or anyone making programming MaxTas or as such, we have no idea what the user is going to use it for. So therefore it needs to be very flexible, and we need to have, in the case of magnetic fields, there's no way for me to know what magnetic fields the user might want to transport his or her neutrons through. And you also needed to make it so that you can have more than one magnet, and you can have magnets within magnets and such. Also, the way these experiments tend to be constructed. And so we came up with this rather simple algorithm. I'm not going to go through it in detail, I guess, but the general gist of it is that we take whenever there's a propagation inside a magnetic field, it's checked how long a step you can take before the magnetic field changes appreciably. And if it changes too much, then you just make the step smaller. And you continue to do so until you have a reasonably constant magnetic field in that area. And then you can take longer steps where you have constant magnetic fields and do Larmor precession on the polarization vector of that particular ray, because remember that it's not a neutron spin. So if you do actually have a polarization vector, then you can do Larmor precession. So let's think about this in a kind of picture. You have a neutron coming in here, there's a magnetic field here, and a magnetic field over here. So we take a step. In this case, it has changed quite a lot. And so we take a smaller step, check if it has changed. And if so, we can move there. And then you can take small steps until you only have small angle changes along the beam. There's some problems with this algorithm, if you really look into it. That this here and the threshold movement, it's kind of difficult to say when has a magnetic field changed too much. That's something that you need to think about. So I've added some functions that you can actually access these constants in time. So you can specify these and play with them until they don't affect your the time where your simulation does not change them for energy. Does not change as a function of these variables, then you have a conversion sensible number already. So, taking a look at the complete sweep of polarization components in MaxTas, there are some magnetic fields, there are some monitors, I haven't really talked about those. There's something called a foil flipper magnet. That's something that's been used to do a spin flip with a magnetic foil in the beam, used at the reactor in Delft, for instance, for the spin echo small angle scattering system that they have. So that's actually being used in exchange for a magnetic field with a very sharp triangular profile, which is difficult to realize, and it's easier to do it with a magnetized foil.
There's some optics.
We'll see. I've taken a look at the guide V mirror. There's a bend, polarizing bender. There's a pi half rotator, with a polarizing mirror, and so on. And we've also got some idealized component. There's an ideal analyzer, which basically analyzes the beam in some direction. That means you get a completely 100% analyzer. And also a polarizer, which is completely idealized. So you set a polarization to something. And that you can use to explore various areas of polarization. There's also a contributed helium-3 component that can be used as an analyzer. At the present, it doesn't work for polarization, as a polarizer, but that will be changed for this. So, another look at the monitors. So this is what I meant by the polar lambda monitor, where you have intensity deposited on a particular curve in the polarization as a function of weight. First, we look at magnetic fields. There are various ways that you can think of these. One of the simpler ones is the constant field. If you just have a constant field, then it's a box with a magnetic field in it. That you can use, and you can specify a wavelength that you want to flip, and then it will calculate the field, the necessary field to do so for you. It has blocking walls, so you can't escape it. There's an even simpler one where you can call a field box. It's just a simple box with a particular magnetic field in it. The nice thing about this one is that you can, in theory, have any kind of magnetic field inside, as long as you can describe it as a function of time and position in a C function. Then you can supply that to the field box, and then it will use that for the magnetic field. Then you can have something more general, which is the B field and B field stock. Now, what are these? These are, in their simplest form, it's a simple window where you enter, and from that point on, and at that point you turn on precession. That means that you will do neutron propagation with normal precession in a magnetic field. The magnetic field will exist until you reach the exit window. That is the stop component. And in between, you can have lots of other components. You can have monitors, guides, whatever. And the magnetic field will stay active until you exit. And you can have any magnetic field, just as before. You can supply a C function that computes the magnetic field within this box. You can also have a table, if you happen to have some other code that can compute magnetic fields from discrete magnets, and so on. Make a table of it, and it will simply transport neutrons through this table of a magnetic field until you turn it off again. Now, these doesn't have to be window shaped. It can be a sphere. It can be a hollow cylinder where you enter here and exit there, and then you have to enter and exit again. But so you can have these complicated geometries where your magnetic field is active and where it's not. And this is one of the things with this is that it's quite. It takes a lot of extra time to also do the normal precession because you have to take small steps through space. So whenever you don't do normal precession, you shouldn't simulate with the normal precession if you don't need to. It will just take very long. And so, we should not actually have a simple word in here, but that's the generalized, that's what I was talking about just before. And as I say, you can have any kind of monitors in along the way, and if you were to think of this as having a constant field, polarization as a function of wave, as we go through one of these region of magnetic field, this is the polarization that you would see for a neutron passing through. It will change more for a short wavelength. Or in a shorter wavelength, they travel faster, so therefore they don't, it will change less. And so you get these very nice curves. The middle monitor will show something like this. You have traveled further along, and therefore you can the polarization will now have done several more, have recessed more. And again, the third monitor is going to be that. At the end, this is what you get after you've turned off the field. Again, so. Now, if you were to have another field, put another field in here, you would get some more precession. Because in this case, I put in a secondary field, which makes the sum of the magnetic field larger. So you can make regions where the field has been changed, and it will end up being the sum of the fields instead. Something that's on the way, there is a magnetic single crystal in that aspect. Will be able to use as a sample. Now in this case it's a lanthanum copper oxide, where I think it's a lanthanum, so the copper atoms are actually the ones that's magnetically active. And if you were to use that on an unpolarized beam, you obviously get the same on spin-up monitor as a spin-down monitor. But if you were to have a polarized beam, then you would get some spin flip scattering and some non-spin flip scattering. So that's something that will be present pretty soon. It's there. And actually this is then just just quoted the equation that governs this magnetic crystal scattering in our model. You can't see it, unfortunately. And yeah, this U function shows up here and here. It's basically defined as this, and this is what we exploit in the simple crystal. And that's what I wanted to say about polarization. As I say, if there's anything else you need to know about polarization, please ask me. There's a lot to be said about it, but thank you. And I should also, just as mass, I will be leaving after lunch, and I would like to thank you all for